to New Hampshire. It kind of has kind of a Newton Vermont vibe going on there. There's like actual normal businesses that accept FRNs and stuff like that. There's a few normal things about Keene, mm-hmm. and I very much appreciate that. But then there's people with about a 3-foot radius hairstyles walking around filming.
You always gotta go after.
You jealous?
You always gotta go after Garrett's hair.
No, what's your beef with that?
I hear jealousy.
Me too. Yeah.
Look, it must be hard. I mean, everybody loves Garrett's hair. He gets compliments on it constantly. Yeah, there's some high school kids that are gonna razz him about it, but besides that,
yeah, well, it's
popular.
Let me put it this way: he wouldn't be the same man he is today without it. His hair makes the man. but it's like,
well,
there's,
I mean,
it's Keene is, real talk for a second, Keene has a different vibe that you won't find anywhere else on planet Earth, and I think that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
I think it's cool. And
it's a unique place.
One thing that I've noticed is that everyone in this community has like this, their own interesting style.
Mm.
Like everyone has a style of the way they dress, the way they look, how they film or whatnot. Everyone has like this own unique style that they put, like a lot, everything that we do, I do anyways. I try to put like my own artistic way of how I want to look and how I want to appear on camera and whatnot. I'm sure Garrett, he has his brand. Like
yeah.
He is a brand of what he looks like. You know,
mm-hmm.
a lot of other people in this community, like people that do similar stuff, they have a brand. Like Dave really has a brand. Like
it's
the same thing. Like everyone, you have a brand. Like the way you go about it. Like everyone has their own brand.
Yeah, Daryl W. Perry
like,
definitely has a brand.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a fascinating thing to see in the community.
Well, it's great. I mean, that's what we need. We need diversity in approaches and tactics so we can reach more people more effectively.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, now, a lot of people have been talking lately about why Manchester? Because Manchester is a real boom town right now with the porcupine community.
Well, why not Manchester?
And,
it's a populated area. There's lots of opportunity.
And it seems like, and one thing that, for all the loving barbs I throw here and there at Keene, without Keene, there wouldn't really be the Free State the way it is today, and I'm eternally grateful for that.
Me too.
What do you feel about the shift?
The shift.
Like, it used to be everyone was moving to Keene.
No, that's not true.
Well, at least, that used to
never
be the perception.
True.
Where was everyone moving back in the day?
All over the place. People have been moving all over New Hampshire since day one of the Free State Project beginning the migration. It's just that Keene is louder than anywhere else and more noticeable because we've been blogging what's been happening.
We're
so therefore, there's a misperception that Keene is the destination.
Exactly. Like outside of New Hampshire, everyone thinks Keene is the Free State Project. Like, I got so many people messaging me when I said I was going to move. Like, oh, you got a job in Keene. You're going to Keene. And a lot of them don't even realize that there's a lot of other people living around the state. But
yeah.
My question is,
why
is
part of Vermont anyway?
No, quite.
That's the old running joke.
Why is it that, you know, I think we're making a difference in regards to talking about what's going on outside of Keene. But why is it there's not that many people doing what we do or talking about what's going on in other parts of the state besides Keene and I guess us now in Manchester?
Well, Garrett, of course, started FreeConcord.org and ultimately ended up moving to Keene to manage the Keene Activist Center. And of course, you know, I'd had him on Free Keene before his move. So, you know, he's an example, but he's also a native. So I guess maybe that doesn't count in the same way as far as like Free Staters. I'd always hoped that there would be more regional kind of newsy blog sites, but it never really panned out. So
yeah.
your guess is as good as mine.
I mean, and to be honest, Concord's kind of Manchester Metro. You know?
Yeah.
And so
sort of.
There's been some more good stuff coming out of Manchester. Like again,
thanks to you.
This right here. Well, thanks, Shire Dudes.
We got another guy on board. We got a third
cool.
guy coming in.
Yeah, and then like Area 23, that whole thing was a huge boom to Manchester. And the whole community, and I hear they're starting to back up again.
That's what I hear. Well, you know, if you build it, they will come, right?
Exactly. There needs to be more of those kind of clubhouses all around the state. You know, I would love to be able to go to like different cities all around New Hampshire, and be able to go and just hang out with other Free Staters and like a Free Stater, you know,
totally.
Buildings and whatnot. Yeah.
There needs to be more people with capital
yes.
here and the willingness to risk it.
Some of those Bitcoin barons need to.
Some of those Bitcoin Darrens. Well, that's the thing is the Free Coast vibe is definitely a much more polished and an affluential and entrepreneurial type vibe. Mm-hmm. And there's a quiet. But here's the thing, at some point, I want to go to the coast and I want to make it loud. And here's the thing, that
Portsmouth would be a great spot.
Yeah, when the free coasters start being loud, that's when you know it's happening. Whatever it's happening. It's not, you know how things move away. It's not the isolated hippie college town. It's not just that big metro center, which there's a lot of people. So of course things happen. It's like, it's the tourist spot, right? Tourists go in and out of the Portsmouth area all over the place. It's really walkable. It's really left status dominated. It's the perfect place. Once we start showing up there, then it's like, holy crap. This is something to pay attention to.
All right, I'll look forward to seeing the video.
Oh, yeah. Well, speaking of which, and this might, why not ask you on air, right? I'm about to pose Merrick, I'm just kidding. July 4th, we're doing
New Hampshire Independence
rally.
The Foundation for New Hampshire Independence?
Yep.
Yeah, we're doing that kind of thing, US out of NH, and we're trying to do it across the state. We're trying to spread our forces and have it in. My vision for it is have something go on in Manchester, Keene, and Portsmouth at the same time.
I'm down. Let's do it.
Can you help take care of the Keene part of that.
I'm not going to film it. I'm going to hand out flyers.
Okay, if you have Garrett or someone there filming. If you can just have that happening in Keene and have it filmed, that's like the big part, because it's not so much what we do, it's what the world thinks we are doing. Mm-hmm. And then we can do Manchester and we'll get something going with the coast. If we can just do that July 4th, make a big splash, bring some porcupines in, show them love, a liberated world.
Yeah, so the Foundation for New Hampshire Independence, have you had anyone on from that group?
I have not.
For listeners or viewers who don't know, that is a group founded by Free State Project participants, maybe a New Hampshire native, I'm not real sure who all was on the founding board there, but to promote the idea of New Hampshire independence or secession.
Yeah, it all blends together at some point, because whether it's friendly natives or Free Staters or pre-staters or Free State friendly movers who aren't part. It's like we're all part of the one big happy.
Most people I don't even know. I mean, a lot of people I don't know them well enough to know if they were here originally from New Hampshire or not. That's just a question you can ask in a polite conversation, basically.
Yeah, it's an interesting vibe how it all becomes the same. But then, like, we have a friend Nate who does a Bitcoin painting business.
Bitcoin painting.
He is like a professional outdoor painter. He's an agorist.
Okay.
And he's just like the most like
local as he comes.
He's like just such a blue collar, work with his hands, like local, who's lived all around the state, and he's just such a normal. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Such a normal, but then he's part of the community because he shows up. He's here at Pork Fest, right? He's going around. It's really nice to see that whole mesh.
Especially like the dynamics of like the community in general. Like being here, you know, usually like an age issue is a big deal, or ethnicity or whatnot. You know, people go into categorize themselves in groups because that's kind of how you were. You know, you went through all your public schooling and you're in that one group of people for like the whole time, so you have that group mentality.
Yeah.
But being here, everyone's here for the same reason, because they want to be free. So like you can go around with different people, whether or not, like case in point. Friday night, we cop-locked a DUI checkpoint in Manchester, and Emily Samblade, who is a self-proclaimed anarchist state rep, is out there, and you know, she's up in her 70s, something like that.
She's pretty
old. She's pretty old. She's out there with an LED sign saying, turn now, police ahead, and whatnot, with all like, our, all of us, youngins, or but it's like, I don't view her as, someone in her 70s. I view her as another human being, and she views us as another.
She's
human
got a lot of energy as well. And
yeah, that's the thing. I've traveled around the world a whole lot. I've been in a lot of different groups and stuff, and I always got along great with people of all different age groups. But there's always been a certain different dynamic, like when I'm with really young people, like children or young teens, I have this sort of mentor feeling to them. And when I'm talking to old people, it's like they sort of have this mentor feeling here. That just doesn't even exist here. Over here, it's like young, old, any age, it's like, it's so weird that there's no difference. We're all equal here. And no one decided that, it just spontaneously happened. I think that's a beautiful thing.
Absolutely.
I start tearing up right now.
It's also nice because, somebody like an Emily Samblade has an ability to get elected to public office without even a second thought by people, because she fits that kind of elderly, office running sort of mold.
Yeah.
And another example is Kathleen Converse, another middle-aged lady who was on the jury that set Doug Darrell free. I don't know if you're familiar with that case, but it was from, I think, about a year ago. She got on a jury, and because she, you know, she looks like kind of a grandmotherly type, not quite, you know, middle-aged, but she fits that kind of juror role, and she got on there, and she flipped this jury to not guilty on a marijuana growing case. It was the first real serious instance of jury nullification here in New Hampshire.
Yeah, and speaking of jury nullification, I mean, thanks for doing all that you do with that, and we're happy to be part of that.
I brought some new flyers, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, so we rock it.
Our studio is becoming like a, it is literally becoming like a propaganda set.
Yeah,
it's the Manch Cac.
I keep like, yeah, it's becoming the Manch Cac, where I keep getting more and more stuff to do and whatnot. Like, we're building up our supplies.
Right. Yeah. So, we're talking about all this wonderful stuff about the community, how things are different here, and how it's just so cool. We can live in this world. It's like, you know, we're all Peter Pan up in here. We never have to grow up. It's like, everything's great. But what, and out in Keene especially, you know, you got your show going, you got freekeene.com, and I'm not going to say that with a new voice. I've done enough of that already. And all these other things, you got your circle of friends, everything's great. But here we go personal, right? Let's go deep. Where do we, what would you be if you got transplanted out of that whole thing? Like, say you just woke up in Belgium, say, I just picked that one random, and you had to like get a normal job to feed yourself, and there's like no liberty
around
you. Or like, what would you as a person, on a very personal level, like, how would that be for you? To like, what would it be? Would it just be a huge culture shock?
Is the question like that, you know, I would remember everything else that I had done and I just showed up in this new place and start from scratch?
Yeah, I'm saying
you never come back to this.
I'm saying, would you just, like, how hard would that be on you personally? But also, like, would you just shrug and, like, start building it back up again where you are?
I mean, I tend to be a pretty positive person, and I don't think that I would really let it get to me. It would be a challenge, obviously, and, you know, being in a new place, you wouldn't know how to speak whatever the main language would be, and you know, there'd be a learning curve, but you'd have a lot more time on your hands. I mean, all my responsibilities would be washed away as well, so I could focus on whatever I needed to.
How many hours a week do you spend doing this?
This meaning
your
activism
thing,
and
your thing.
Your thing, like, you know, whether it's radio, activism, whatever, in LRN.
That's hard to really calculate. I mean, because I can pour as much time in as I want to. And I usually want to pour a lot of time in because, you know, it's my business is also activism.
Yeah.
And I do Free Talk
Live. I think
Live.
The correct answer of how many hours is all of them.
Pretty much, you know, when I'm awake, and my only real vice is Facebook at this point. Like, I feel like I spend way too much time there. So.
But it's an activist tool, isn't
it?
I know. Every time I'm on Facebook feeling bad about how awful Facebook is as far as the time sink, then I'll find something really valuable, like, oh, there's a cool event I needed to know about that.
Well, I mean, this community lives and dies on Facebook.
Unfortunately.
Like, you have to be on Facebook, and, like, I use it as a networking tool.
I'm totally as well, but I also can catch myself doing things that are not networking.
Yeah, true.
Just scrolling down the news feed incessantly. That's bad.
Well, honestly, it was Facebook that sort of brought me here.
Was it?
I was
same here.
I heard about the Free State Project. I started looking into things. I got connected with some groups, specifically the Free Coaster group. And then I just was watching. I was just living everyone's lives vicariously for about a good 6 months. Mm-hmm. And then I have to say a big shout out to Vanessa Vine, because it was her Instagram that triggered my move.
No kidding.
Because just seeing all those gorgeous pictures of Portsmouth and stuff, and that just really made me like, I want to be here. And she's working overtime here at Porkfest doing the same thing. She has some couple really cool, candid puppy shots.
And I did a talk at All Expo on Tuesday about kind of similar thing, where more people in the community need to just post what their life is like here. Like, take photos of what they're doing, talk about going to a meetup or whatnot.
Their
and
beer,
friend
their bottom, their coin.
Like, you know, I've been going around, if I ever meet someone that's, you know, the first time at Porkfest and they've never been to New Hampshire or interested, I'm like, look, all you gotta do is go to a bunch of Facebook Free Seder groups. Friend as many people as you can. Some of them will accept it and make friends and make connections and follow what their lives are like. Hopefully they post more pictures and tell the story of this unique lifestyle that we're all living. Because this is very unique. This is a very, very unique lifestyle. And I did the same thing. I was following many different people within the community. community before I got here, especially when he moved, he stopped at my place first. So then I'm like, I really have to follow his journey, because like, he just left my apartment, he's going there, so like, I gotta follow this, what's going on, and just seeing...
I think he fell in love because I left him some Mexican churros and coffee.
Oh, that's good coffee.
And I
went out. When are you going to come back?
I'm going to Arizona in like August or so. Yeah, and I'm going to be turning hero, talking to everyone about how awesome it is in Shire. Hopefully I'll bring some people with me, but at the very least, I'm going to get my fucking coffee hookup. And do you like coffee?
It's really good coffee.
Yeah, I'm fine with coffee. I don't really spend time drinking it, though.
You don't spend time, so you just do like shots. There we go. It's not a lot of time.
No, you're right. We need more storytellers. And yeah. We need more people to, if not tell their own story, someone else tell their story. And they need to be in more places, which is why I've tried to bring as many people in from like Manchester at Free Keen, just to give an outlet for some of those stories. And we can only tell a fraction of them, but I think that
anytime,
people find that very interesting.
Anytime you want me on Free Talk Live, then I'm not working. I'll show up.
Okay,
show you
cool.
some love.
I appreciate that.
And so, also one thing I'm doing on a specific, again, this is where we all whore ourselves out with our little particular project. I do a lot of stuff for the Desert Links, my YouTube channel. I try to make short, condensed, like more artistically appealing storytelling videos about the community. And so like I've done one about Rich Paul's life, the 5.5 minute
yep.
one.
I saw that
one. I've done the one about when Rob bought the car from Daryl Perry with a Bitcoin.
Mm-hmm.
I did one about the Acris cab. I'm going to do one about the Shire Co-op as soon as I get back. I'm sure a million out of Porkfest, right? That's why we come. And we have like months of work ahead of us. Just
yeah,
from
I have footage going around events and like capturing like moments that you wouldn't. I caught this great moment yesterday.